everyone, and welcome to Storytime with KidsCon. Today we are going to be reading Arnie the Elephant by Paul Gibbs and illustrated by Ingrid Eckhart. Ollie the Elephant. My name is Ollie, and I was born on a very hot and dry day, with typical African thick black storm clouds growing in the distance. It was a monumental occasion for my mother, Zuni, as she had carried me in her tummy for 22 months. My grandmother was leader of the herd. I don't remember being born, but I know I had to stand up and start moving not long after falling to the ground. The slimy stuff I was covered in dried quickly, thank goodness, but oh, it was sticky. My mother nursed and cared for me for many, many months, as I was so small, nudging me along when I couldn't keep up with the herd. I was often afraid I would be left behind when the herd marched to a new watering hole. All my family members were so huge that there was a danger I would be trampled on, no matter how careful or concerned they were. My cousin Mfana almost lost his foot one day when Mandleve, a big bull elephant, accidentally trod on his leg. Luckily, he was just bruised, but lumbered along with a distinct limp for a few storms afterwards. I made sure I stayed close to my mother for safety, just as all children should, and I had so much to learn. The males in the herd had such big tusks, mine grew slowly. But my mother assured me they would grow big and strong, just like theirs. I wanted to know how long that would take, much too long for me to possibly imagine. Our home is between two rivers, the Okavango and the Zambezi. Mostly, we live and roam the thick bush, desert and hills in the wilderness areas of Africa, in search of fresh food and water. The adults use their strong tusks to tear down thorn bushes and uproot acacia trees. There are over 150,000 muscles in an elephant's trunk, so we can all eat the succulent leaves and softer branches at the top. But our favorite fruit is the delectable marula berry from the marula tree. Humans say that elephants get drunk on these berries, but that is not true. We love to bathe and play in the rivers, lakes, or even a muddy watering hole, rolling and caking our thick hides in mud. This dries and keeps us cool during the summer, especially those very hot days before the big rains come. We youngsters are always worn out after a long trek through the bush, so we spend the longest time possible in the mud. Baby Toomey was once well and truly stuck in the mud after sliding down the wet bank created by the bigger elephants. "Help me," she squealed, "I'm stuck." "What's the problem? Just push yourself out and clamber back up," was the advice Mandleve trumpeted out at full volume.
"But I'm only small. Look at how big you are. It's not that easy, you know."
"Suit yourself." With that, he shook his large ears and wandered off away to break off another branch.
"Don't worry, I'll help," I told her in a soothing tone. "He has just forgotten what it's like to be young." "Oh, thank you, Ollie," Toomey said. "You're always so kind and helpful."
"Hey, Mfana," I called. "Come and lend a trunk to help me with poor Toomey." Mfana was older than me and much stronger. We both slid down to where muddy little Toomey was stuck. "Right, put your trunk under while I push with my tusks." "Okay. Here we go, push," coached Mfana. There was a loud sucking noise and baby Toomey squealed with delight as she was freed from the mud and scrambled up the bank to be reunited with her mother atop the muddy pool.
"Oh, thank you so much. I am so grateful," she tooted as she ran off to roll in the dust.
Excited by her frolic, she gently rubbed her mother's flank with her tiny head, reinforcing their unbreakable bond. Toomey started sucking the sweet milk which ran down the sides of her mouth, forming dark streaks on her dusty hide. Baby elephants can feed up to 3 or 4 years from their mother,
or until the milk dries up. All the children in the herd are disciplined by the other mothers in the herd, so it doesn't pay to be naughty. But we know that if our mother dies, we will be adopted by one of the other mothers. Baby Tumi finished suckling and ran around flapping her ears and trunk in a show of extreme joy. "Had enough, my baby?" her mother asked. Tumi lifted her trunk and blew a shrill, piercing trumpet sound to let everyone know she was full. Her mother put her trunk around her and hugged Tumi happily. "Well, listen to that. Sounds like joy to me, eh, Mfana?" "Oh yes, she really is a sight to watch," he said. The crisis over, the herd moved away from the waterhole into the thick Mopani forest, followed by the youngsters who called out, "Wait for us, we're only little." It is important for us all to look out for predators. They watch and wait to catch the weakest or the stragglers in our herd. Another cousin, Moro, was nearly chomped by an overzealous lion cub. Luckily for Moro, his mother, Sitara, realized he had fallen behind and charged the lion cub, chasing him up a big marula tree. Sitara shook the tree with all her might, and the cub, who had been clinging on to a branch in terror, leapt into a thorn shrub and then ran for her life. The cub didn't dare look back or turn for a quick snarl. "I'm sure that lion will never again chance her luck with our herd, and I'm sure that Morla will not be so silly in future." Poachers are also a big problem. The rangers are on constant alert for them coming to Botswana from Zimbabwe. The people there are very hungry and poor, as there has often been no rain to help their crops grow. Very often, though, they don't want to kill us for food. They just want to take our ivory tusks to sell for a lot of money. Sipiwe, another cousin, who's as tough as a bull's hide, not so long ago stepped around one of those horrible wire snares. It tightened around his leg, and the more he pulled to escape, the tighter it became. He was in agony as the wire cut deep into his flesh. He could do nothing but limp in circles around the snare, trumpeting for help. The rest of the herd raced to help, but could do nothing to free him. Luckily, the next sunrise brought good luck as a group of rangers, who had been tracking us for a few days, spotted the wire embedded in his leg. Normally, we only tolerate the rangers at a distance, but this time we let them get close enough to help our family member. They shot a dart, which made Sipiwe sleepy, and he fell to the ground with a crash. It was very frightening, as I thought he was dead. The air was filled with shouts as the rangers chased us away from Sipiwe. We made sure we stayed close enough to keep an eye on the strange creatures. One ranger checked to see if Sipiwe was asleep, and the other took a wet cloth and covered his eyes. If Sipiwe had been awake, he would have tossed them into the air with his tusks. I saw Mandleva toss a hyena into a vachabeki thorn tree once. That one-eyed hyena never came close to us again. The ranger then took pliers and cut the wire away. There was an ugly gash, but at least Sipiwe was free of the snare. When he woke up, the ground shook as he battled to get back on his feet. He looked dazed and confused, but finally flapped his ears a few times to cool down. When we get overheated, we flap our ears many times so blood will flow through our ears and the air cools our body. Many of our friends have been caught in these snares and died. The poachers sometimes take our meat and sell our beautiful tusks to criminals. Lots of humans are trying to stop this terrible trade. As our herd moves off into the sinking sun, a slight breeze blows from across the plains and the heavy scent of elephants hangs in the air. The wilderness will forever be the home for large elephant herds like mine and many other wild animals, just as we are all part of the puzzle of Africa. Wasn't that great, everyone? Are you the elephant? So you can see how much good humans can do when they come together to save animals. I hope everyone enjoyed the story, and I can't wait to see you again. Bye.